Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our Tuesday morning session of our I Love America conference. At this point, we're trying to sing some people up from downstairs. They flew upon the spoil. They're lingering by the stuff, and we're trying to get them. We're trying to dislodge them from maple bars and apple fritters and Cocoa Krispies and Fruit Loops and things like that. Well, hopefully, eventually, they will make it. We're going to start in this book. Is there anyone you do not have this book yet? Just looking around, raise your hand. I'll make sure Mick gets you one. Just looking so far, everybody has that. If you look inside here, there is a chorus. I'm going to have you stand. It's a wonderful chorus. It's called "You're a Grand Old Flag." And we're going to sing this one. And some of you go, oh yeah, this one, I sing this all the time. I just go, I've never seen this in my life. And so anyway, we'll get this going. You're a grand old flag. So let's sing this one together.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of the land I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true under red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. But should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
Let's do that again.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of the land I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true neath the red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. But should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
And now remain standing and find your songbook and turn to number 127. What an amazing and beautiful song. The person who wrote this song, they were in love with their country. And it comes out in the words of the song, just how they feel. They love the sky. I mean, it's like if there is anyone here from Montana, they love the sky. They call it Big Sky Country. And there's certain things people like about the different states they live in. But this is a song about the entire country and what God has done. And understanding, the person didn't say God shed his blessings on us. He said God shed his grace. Grace is something we get that is good that we don't deserve. And indeed, America, you know, yes, we're under blessing, but we're under grace. We're under God's mercy. Mercy is the other thing. Mercy is not getting what we do deserve. And so we certainly understand mercy. So let's sing this song together.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesty above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for pilgrim feet whose stern impassioned stress, a thoroughfare for freedom beat across a wilderness. America, America, God mend thy every flaw, confirm thy soul in self-control and liberty and long. Oh, beautiful for heroes' room in liberating strife, who more than self their country love and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
And at this time, I'm going to ask a Pastor Ron Reasoner to come up. He's going to open us up in a word of prayer this session. I'm still looking at that phrase, patriot dream that sees beyond the years. They were not trying to create a great America for their generation. They're trying to create a great America for your generation and for other generations to come. And so, good. Hello there, my dear brother. Is it Pastor Stevenson?
Pastor Farinella.
Oh, Brother Farinella. I'm sorry, I didn't recognize you. You're not in your motorcycle outfit this time. I am so grateful that you came and it was not 115 degrees. I'm glad to have you here. Hey, that's it. We'll see you later. Don't go away. We'll be right back. And we're going to begin in a word of prayer right now. Brother Reasoner, pray for him. Not in a battle for his ministry. Bless God.
Amen.
Ministry is wonderful. It's just this little thing called a building.
Yes.
and just anyway, pray for him. He is working so very, very hard. They call it to put a nail in the place. He's trying to do that. So pray for him as he tries to get not only his church, which is established, but a building established in Vancouver, Washington. Go ahead.
Well, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for who you are and what you did for us on the cross. I pray that you would bless this meeting in a special way as we look at the freedom that we have in America, and we see the answers in prayers through Roe v. Wade and even that football coach that was able to continue to pray in the middle of the field. We're seeing victories through prayer, and we know it's through prayer.
Yes.
And it's the only way that we can see these things happen. And we were just so thankful that you're still with us. And I pray for a great revival to take place throughout America. This is our hope, that the wickedness will be turned back by the way, and we'll see the light of the gospel shining strong through America. I pray for a great revival throughout our country. I pray for a great revival within us throughout this meeting. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, and you may be seated. In the book of Numbers, chapter 27, God indicated his final plan for the earthly life of Moses. In fact, God said this to him in verse 12, and the Lord said unto Moses, get thee up into this Mount Abarim and see the land which I have given unto the children of Israel. And when thou hast seen it, thou also shalt be gathered unto thy people, as Aaron thy brother was gathered. Reading in verse 15, and Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation, which may go out before them, and which may go in before them, and which may lead them out, and which may bring them in, that the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep which have no shepherd. Moses was an old man facing death. He had seen God's miracles. He had faced opposition. He had seen the terrible consequence of a disobedient nation, but had seen also a God who conquers and delivers. When faced with death, he had only one question: who will come after me? He had already seen what God already knows. People are like sheep, and this is not always a compliment. They need leadership. They need guidance. A short time later, Moses penned, by the guidance of the Holy Spirit of God, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 9, to publish what God already knew about man in generations. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. And tell President Biden we can't take him right now. Put him on hold. Understand this. This is the lesson at the end of the life of a great, godly, patriotic man. The next generation must have vision, or they will wander, they will fail, they will perish. One generation must teach the next repeatedly, patiently, even obnoxiously, if they are not prone not to listen. Because people, even Americans, are like sheep. And this is not always a compliment. They need leadership. They need guidance. They need a courageous Joshua-like leader who will carry the mantle of godliness and patriotism to another generation. And this is the burden of the older generation. At this time, we're going to sing a chorus that we sang last night. It is a prayer to God, and it is the song, Lord, Heal Our Land, because America is in need of healing. There's been some hope. Maybe the healing process is beginning. We don't know, but we need to beseech the Lord to heal our land. Let's sing this chorus. It's in your book. Let's sing this chorus together.
Lord, heal our land. Father, heal our land. Hear our cry and turn our nation back to you. Hear us, O Lord, and heal our land. Forgive our sin and heal our broken land.
Let's sing that one again.
Lord, heal our land. Father, heal our land. And turn. turn our nation back to you. Lord, heal our land. Hear us, O Lord, and heal our land. Forgive our sin and heal our broken land.
Now, at this time, I'd like to recognize we've had some people that have come into town that were not here last night. Even a few more will be in for the next session. But if you were not here last night as a pastor or a missionary, if you could stand right now and we'll just introduce. And I need ushers in different spots. Brother Carl, I'll let Andrew, you'll be the gift man. Okay, I'll let Andrew be the gift man. Mix, looks like Mick's a mug man there. We mug all our visitors. And so, right here, I'm going to start here with Pastor Farinella. Go ahead. Amen. Last year he won the Man Times Temperature Award. Motorcycle. You know what is amazing? Windchill just doesn't work at 115 degrees. And I felt so bad because he got here and he actually missed the sessions. Got down, was able to do a little fellowship so he could get back on that motorcycle in that hot night. Go to Graceway Baptist Camp and bake at camp over there. What a man. I tell you, you are gracious. I'm so glad you came. I'm glad it's cooler for you this year. I feel like I should buy you a bag of ice or something. And so grateful for that. And then right over here. Amen. Did you get, Andrew, you got them their gifts? Okay, very good. And you've been properly mugged? Okay, that's wonderful. Just want to make sure that's going on. Let me make mention real quick. Brother Kaminsky, I'm going to have you come up. He's going to give a testimony here. Let me give a program note here. Go ahead and come on up. For those of our workers who work in Subtle Care, we will not be having our afternoon Bible study. Obviously, we're completely occupied today. That Bible study has been moved to Wednesday. It's been moved one day later at the same time. Anyway, just wanted to let you know that. And Brother Kaminsky is a blessing here at Berean Baptist Church. We had him here on Sunday. He preached our God and Country Day. But, Brother, I have to say this to you. You must have preached only to one side, because look at what's happened here. I'm looking at Southside Baptist Church, and I'm looking at Northside Baptist Church here. So, Pastor Wells, I need you to balance things out. This morning, you're just going to pay attention to them. They're going to get, then they'll start migrating back to the north. And so, Amen. Anyway, Amen. Go ahead. Thank you.
Love coming into a church and causing a church split. Amen. I'll tell you what, I fell in love with Berean Baptist coming here. Actually, our first time in Pendleton. We drove out here 43 years ago in a school bus and passed by Pendleton, probably didn't even notice it, as the police stopped us four times once we got into Oregon. We knew we were where God wanted us because opposition started right in Oregon. Well, 43 years ago, we started Camp Northwest. So I would like to say a little bit about that as we talk about training the next generation. I hope we understand today that we are in not only a moral crisis, but we're in a church crisis. One, the Word of God seems to be diminishing and the prosperity gospel is taking over. But two, there are not men to fill the pulpits. When I graduated from college, there were 10 men for one position. Today, there's 10 positions for one man. And we need to pray and ask God to help. And I thank the Lord for camp ministries. There's Graceway, and I know there's a new camp up in Montana and things like that. And I just want to encourage you in whatever camp. But 43 years ago, we started Camp Northwest. It was heavy on my heart as I grew up in Michigan in a Catholic home and went to Detroit area where we moved. And there I was invited by young people from a Baptist church, teenagers, to go to youth camp. And so I went. And at age 15, I found Jesus Christ as my Savior. And then the next year, at age 16, God called me in the ministry. And that burden has been on our hearts for these past 43 years. The camp is located about just over an hour from Portland in Washington. And we have about 500 to 600 attend that camp in our 2 weeks. We have a junior camp and a senior camp. And there's information on the back table. I'd hope that you would pick it up about our camp this year and our speakers and everything. And then there's a green card for all of you who could pick up and just let us know what the dilemma is with our young people. As we know, the electronic age and relationships is being diminished, and even the heart for church and all this. And one of the statistics on there is only 15% of the average church budget is designated for youth programs. And 24% of pastors do not necessarily see youth ministries as a priority. And so at camp, we have set aside our theme of our camp is the purpose of Camp Northwest is to evangelize the lost and disciple believers so that lives will be changed by God's power and for His glory. We at camp try to emphasize leadership development through our staff training, getting our kids away from their phones and electronics, having daily devotions, uplifting music, discipleship, biblical preaching, good activities, and good food. And I thank the Lord for the privilege that we've had to see many, many kids get saved over the years. And many, many young people are on the mission field and pastors today as well. One statistics a long time ago, I don't know how it rates today, but one group said that 65% of missionaries are on the field because they received their call at youth camp. So I pray that the Lord would help us with that. There are scholarships available, and we try to help kids to come. We even have a buddy scholarship because I realized how important it was for me. The teenagers of the church there invited me to go, and it was made possible to go. And so we actually have scholarships for teenagers and kids to invite their lost friends that are not associated with your church, and we help them to go to camp. And one other thing that we do is we give scholarships for our kids at camp. We give scholarships for them to go and to fulfill going to a Bible college. As you know, they're not easy to get scholarships there. And as a man in our church passed away and he wanted to help kids to be able to go and prepare for ministry, at this point now we've given over $100,000 to help kids go to Bible school to prepare for ministry. So I really want to encourage you on that. And if I were to get into patriotism for the next generation, we truly want them to see Christ as their Savior. That really is the hope for America. Amen to that? You know, I don't have a red, white, and blue tie, but I have these. You ever know? Yeah, how many have seen this before? Yeah, many have seen this. All right, so some of you see that. So which one is bigger? The red. All right. Now I'm gonna do my little magic trick back here, and now I want to tell you which side is bigger. Isn't that amazing? But you know, it is perspective, because as you see things in the way that God sees things, it changes how you see things. Amen to that. And I thank the Lord for the gospel. But one thought on patriotism is just over 2 weeks ago, I was able to go to Alabama to watch my son-in-law retire from the Army, 21 years of service. And I can't tell you how many times I shed tears on that military base as I saw those soldiers gather together to cheer their comrades. I thought to myself, oh, if we could have this in our churches. They fought together in battle, and my son-in-law was an Army Ranger for 10 years of his service in special ops, parachuting out of planes and going into the front line on 12 tours in Afghanistan and Iraq. And as I heard about it, I was standing there looking at a hero. Then he became an Apache attack helicopter pilot for 10 years. Man, I'm telling you what, I was so proud to be an American. And I thought to myself, if our young people could just step on a base and see our soldiers and understand the heritage of our country. I went into the VA hospital. My dad, who's living with us now, he's 90 years old, was in the Korean War. And there was a sign next to the secretary where we're getting him enrolled with the VA hospital. And it says, "I died for you. Are you worth dying for?" And I looked at that and I thought, oh my, oh my. And of course, it made me realize one other aspect of it. Jesus Christ died for me. Amen. And I get saved. The Bible says in Psalm 33 and verse 12, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance." Aren't we glad we're Americans? And aren't we glad that we're born again? Thank you. The hope for America is us spreading the gospel and being God's light. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And at this time, I'm going to have Mrs. Deborah Wells is coming up. She is going to sing just a couple program notes. Downstairs in the fellowship hall, there is a table at the far end under a sign says "Proud Flag Waving Christian" down at the bottom there. And most of that stuff is free for the taking. And there's pictures of George Washington speaking about patriotism and testimony of a soldier by the evangelist Tim Lee. And there's for the youth get first stab at this. There are some books for youth there. Rush Revere, some of you already have had that series before, but I'd have one of the books that's come in, and that is for free for the taking for the youth. Youth get first crack at that. Then next to it, there's a book. The book is $5 each, but it's a book called Good News, written by Pastor Addison Smith a couple years ago. I guess it's one of the advantages of COVID, supposedly gives you a little time. But it's the burden of his heart to write this book, and I want you to tell the youth, I know you're going to speak down there, but tell them why. Tell them why you wrote the book, because I think it's something that they may really, really want down there. So program note here, Mrs. Wells is going to sing. By the way, isn't it great having a house full of music? And so in my house, there's a piano in my house, and my wife plays the piano. I am so spoiled. It really, really is good. I really enjoy it. But it's just such a wonderful thing what music can do and how it can change a heart and a change a life. And Pastor Wells is going to speak. We will finish 11-ish. And then we will take a 10-minute break, and it'll be maybe 11:10-ish, and then everything will end at noon-ish. And I put the ish in here because I want the Holy Spirit of God to be able to kind of work and motate things. I don't want somebody to stop prematurely if God's leading them to do something. But anyway, Mrs. Wells is going to sing for us right now.
Let me step up here. Just give a brief introduction. You're doing which one?
I don't know.
Got back from Israel. And one of the places we went and saw is a place called Masada. And that's called, that's actually a Hebrew word, which means the fortress. There's very good evidence that David and his men hid from Saul in the fortress, got him to the stronghold. And he hid in both En Gedi, the river and the cave system, and the fortress of Masada. As you look across the valley and the plain, there's Mount Sodom off to the right. And there are five white ashen patches out in this dry valley, which probably was green 3,000 years ago. We went down into those white patches. Those were five cities covered in ash. And we, with my own hands, pulled pieces of yellow, white sulfur balls out of the ash. All the people of the area for all these centuries have known these were the original cities of pride that fought against God, Sodom and Gomorrah. There was a righteous man. The New Testament declares there was a righteous man, quite possibly a very powerful man that sat at the gate, had incredible influence but did not use it for God and lost the generation. The story of Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot.
Did you tell them we were there during the Pride Week? I haven't sung this song probably since 2009, so please bear with me. I pray God will use it. Lot was a righteous man, God said. His soul was vexed from day to day by wicked men surrounding him, who mocked his God and loved their sin. Other actions angered him. He never could stand up to them. Lot was a busy man, some say. Sat at the gate from day to day. He must have done a lot of good, just not what he should, until the judgment day was near. But then they didn't want to hear. For 50, oh, would you spare their lives? And if you found 45, 30, 20, what if you found 10? But they could only find him. It was a wicked place, we say. Their cry was great from day to day. Yet if perhaps the righteous one a mighty work could have done, tell me, what did Jesus say? It would have remained until this day. Lot, oh Lot, if only you'd had the strength to show me a mighty work of a living God, his mercy, his love. If only you'd cared enough to share, I would be spared. I would be spared. And now a modern Sodom's here, plagued with sin, we're paralyzed with fear. Or maybe when our anger shows, they don't care what we know. Or is it all the busyness that keeps us from the thing that's best? Oh, could we not reach out to them? He came to save them from their sin. Righteous one, if only you'd have the strength to show me the mighty works of a living God, his mercy, his love. If only you'd care enough to share, I would be spared.
Thank you, Deborah. And take your Bibles, if you would, this morning. Let's go to Romans chapter number 8. Romans chapter number 8. Our trip to Israel, I would not say was a life-changing trip, because I feel like we've been placed on the right course and our faith was in place. But it was a faith-affirming place. We went and we saw it, and it's all right there. Things that are 4,000 years old and 3,000 years old and 2,000 years old, and it's all right there, just like the Bible says. Just like the Bible says. Romans chapter 8 is one of the favorite passages of all time. Of course, Romans chapter 8. And look at verse number 28. You know this verse. Romans 8 and 28. Let's say that together. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. It's a beautiful, reaffirming promise that God is good and God's going to use whatever disaster or element is present and afflicting us for His purpose, for our good and His glory. And we are not wrong to claim that. But manifestations of Mother Nature and human nature cause the populace to really wonder, is there a God? And if there is a God, does God care? If God cares, is He capable? And those are the two accusations that the devil will throw into your mind in any sort of calamity, whether it's a storm or it's a shooting and some horrific thing that happens. And we need to realize that the devil is the accuser of the brethren, but more so than that, the accuser of God to the brethren. And he will accuse God of not caring or not being capable. And so Romans chapter 8, I'd like to just give three short points in the few minutes that we have remaining. A biblical response to violence, chaos, and disaster. Now, this is very key and very important, because every young person is wondering, with all this trouble and all this pain and all this hurt and heartache, either in my life or in somebody I know's life, how can there be a God? Now, in Romans chapter 8, right before verse number 28, which we said together, there are three times the Bible uses the word groans. And groaning or sighing is actually a very common thing. You probably groaned or sighed many times in the last week. As a matter of fact, they say, the doctors that is, say that there is a manifestation of a broken will and an extremely heavy heart when you can't stop sighing. As a matter of fact, I've seen that, where somebody will just, and they just continue to sigh. As a matter of fact, I've felt that in my own life. As I've wrestled with this and that, I felt weak, broken, and I've heard myself sigh, and I can't stop sighing. You've probably felt the same thing. Well, the Bible gives three different instances of that, and I want to look at those just briefly this morning. First, an encouraging word from verse number 18, Romans 8 and verse number 18. The Bible says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Now, how many of you have southern roots? Southern roots. All right, you got it. We got a few. Sometimes we think of that word reckon as just kind of, I guess. But it's much more direct than that. It's more I calculate, I figure. It's kind of an accounting term. And you reckon things. And you make the books balance. It's actually a lot of work. And it takes that brain, that mathematical, exacting, perfectionist brain, to sit down and balance the books and spend 3 hours finding 3 pennies. I'm missing 3 cents. I'm going to go over the books again. How many of you have that sort of brain? How many of you don't understand that brain at all? Okay. Yeah. All right. For I reckon. And here Paul is saying, I am calculating, and I reckon that the sufferings of this present life are not even worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Hold on to that. Verse number 19. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Now he's talking there about the things God created, the various elements of creation, which are referred to as the creature. So it's referring collectively to creation, the individual creatures that God created that make up all of creation. Again, in verse number 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity. Speaking of all that God made when Adam and Eve fell, all of God's creation was made subject to an emptiness, a hollowness. Is life worth living attitude? What am I doing this for? And I felt that. You felt that. For the creature, all of creation, was made subject to vanity, not willing, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Adam subjected all of humanity. Verse 21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. So we're in the bondage of corruption right now. Unto the glorious liberty of the children of God. So there's the hope. One day we'll be delivered from corruption and we'll be brought into the blessing of God, the liberty of the children of God. And here it is in verse 22, our first point. For we know that the whole creation, what? Groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Now, my dad taught me to really appreciate the beauty of nature. And as we were driving as a kid, he would always say, look at the mountains and look at the trees and look at the flowers and look at the grass. And, ooh, I saw a deer and, ooh, I saw this and that. And so now I have passed that on to my kids. As a matter of fact, it's kind of a running joke in my home that dad's always pointing out all this stuff. And if anybody's looking at their phone or at the road, there's only one person that should be looking at the road. That's the driver. Everybody else should be looking at the marvelous creation of God all around us. So, Dad, thank you for instilling that into my life. But here it is in verse 22. The beauty all around us is in the bond of vanity. It's actually the mountains and the trees and the grass, they're all groaning. The Bible says that creation is groaning. So our first point here is creation groans. And what is the creation groaning in? It's in the bondage of corruption. God didn't intend it this way. God made creation. God made this world magnificent and beautiful. The animal world, they are living in vanity. And you look at the hostility back and forth with all of the animals and the curse that was given there in the Garden of Eden, and you'll crawl on your belly, and how magnificent it was. We don't even know. We have no idea. But it's groaning. The mineral world, God said, cursed is the ground. The plant world, the thorns and the thistles, and if you were to walk through the desert that hasn't been groomed and planted and cared for, well, there'd be thorns and thistles. You couldn't, it wouldn't be enjoyable. It'd be awful. You'd be scratched and clawed at the whole way. It takes a great amount of effort to make things hospitable and be brought into a nice habitat. And that's, God created the world for a beautiful habitat, but it's held in the bondage of corruption. And only man with the sweat of his brow and the labor and the breaking of his back, and is he going to eat of the fruit of the field? The first thing is the groaning of creation. Creation groans. But the next verse shows the second groaning, and that's Christians groan under the burden of suffering, which is our main point here. Creation groans, the bondage of corruption, and Christians groan in the burden of suffering, in verse 23. And not only they, but ourselves also. We're groaning also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. That is, we're Christians, even as we ourselves groan, there's our word, within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. And we're all waiting, and corruption is holding it, and we live in suffering. And Apostle Paul here is writing, and he's writing, this is one of the prison epistles. As a matter of fact, we were in Caesarea, and there's two big Caesareas in Israel, Caesarea Philippi. That's the first place. It's up in the northern section. It's where the place where Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And Jesus said that actually at a place that's called the gates of hell, because idolatry was all around. But that's not Caesarea Philippi, which is named after Caesar and Philip, but Caesarea down by the coast, Caesarea Maritime, which was King Herod the builder, his main house and his fortress, his headquarters, and Apostle Paul's prison cell, which was not a dark, dank, horrible place, but a very high political prison just outside of King Herod's house. As a matter of fact, it's marked. I've got a picture of it. And we're standing there, my wife and I, here we are. This is where Paul was. And he wrote about the groaning of suffering. And we groan within ourselves. And he's writing, facing execution, knowing that he had suffered, and thousands are suffering and will suffer. A few cross-references, Romans chapter 5. Let's just go back a page or two. Romans chapter 5. Everybody feeling okay this morning? We're feeling good. At verses 1 through 5, it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. We glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed. Let's say that together. And hope maketh not ashamed. Listen, God leads us through these problems so that we can be courageous and fearless and unashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. We Christians groan under the burden of suffering, but we also have hope, and we realize that God is bringing us to the place of courage. Let me read another passage to you. Just move forward in your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and look at verse number 7. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. That is, we have a spiritual blessing, the treasure of eternal life, but it's housed in a physical body. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. In other words, God doesn't allow us to take credit or foolishly think somehow we are the ones that are getting this job done. Verse 8, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. That is, with our body, while we're still groaning, while there's trouble on every side, we want to make manifest to the lost and dying world, there is hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not hope in my personality. It's not hope in my heritage. These are extremely limiting things. It's not hope in my education or my unique little place. What is the hope? The hope is in the Lord Jesus Christ, which died for all. God so loved not just the Jewish people. God so loved the what? The world. The world. So creation groans in the bondage of corruption. Christians, that is, we groan under the burden of suffering. You know what Jesus said? You will have tribulation. You will have tribulation. Job said this, though he slay me, what did he say? Say it with me. Yet will I trust him, but I will maintain mine own way before him. He says, I am going to be upright, I'm going to be pure, I'm going to have integrity, I'm going to manifest godly character no matter what happens. And he was aware that God was letting this happen. Now, this is absolutely important as we live in a time that's filled with human problems and natural disasters. There's going to be another calamity. It's going to be manifested by the news. There's going to be another big storm. And the news people are going to send their camera boys there and they're going to take pictures and people are going to be crazy. Then foolish people are going to stand up and use this horrendous tragedy. They are going to monopolize upon the misery for their own gain, their own promotion. And then there'll be political finger-pointing. But our job, your job, is to say God is good. God is great. God is good. God cares, and he's capable. Yes, creation groans. Yes, even we, Christians, groan. But though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Let's say that together. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. We're going to trust the Lord. Let me give you one last point. So we see creation groans under the bondage of corruption. We see Christians groan under the burden of suffering. But here's the third point, and the third time in Romans chapter number 8, that the word groan is used. So if I'm not in Romans 8, there we go. We're back again. Verse number 24. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. In other words, we don't really know how to pray very well. But the Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit itself, maketh intercession for us with what? With groanings which cannot be uttered. And that's really the context of the whole thing. Creation groans. The faithful followers of Christ, they're groaning. But here's the third element. The Holy Spirit of God is groaning for us in a way, in a voice, in a language of prayer. Now, in verse 26, it says, the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us. Sometimes people would foolishly accuse the Bible as being treating the Holy Spirit with irreverence and saying it instead of making it personal as him, the Spirit himself. But they don't understand. They don't understand. See, it can be depersonalizing, but in this case, it's not lowering it. It's elevating it. This is a reference to the Holy Spirit of God as something higher than just humanity. And that's what's going on. It can be used as a lowering, but this case, it is elevating it. And that's also used as the Lord Jesus Christ is referred to as an it one other time. And it's not speaking of gender or any foolishness like that. And it's certainly not lowering it. It is saying, it is revealing his deity, that Jesus is higher than just humanity. So verse number 26, the Holy Spirit is groaning for us. The Comforter groans with the blessing of intercession for us. And verse 27, and he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. You know what? Our world is groaning. The natural world is groaning. The trees and... it's not all happiness and joy. Christians are groaning under the burden of suffering, but the Holy Spirit of God is groaning. Now, just by way of conclusion, I don't really want to try to sing a song or give an invitation, but what I'd like you to do is just somebody near you, I'd like you to pray with them. And if you need to move around, that's fine. That's great. But let's just have just 3 to 5 minutes of prayer and partner with the Holy Spirit. And whatever is heavy on your heart, maybe it's your children, maybe it's your state, maybe it's your nation, maybe it's the Supreme Court, maybe it's some ruling, maybe it's something I don't even know about. Whatever's heavy on your heart, would you partner with the Holy Spirit and just bring that heavy heart to the Lord right now in prayer. All right? Go ahead. It's your time. Go ahead. Move around anywhere you want. Let's pray.